The world of streaming heating up with the focus now shifting to international growth. One major player has a head start, expanding though to more than 220 countries worldwide. Joining us now is David Zaslav, Discovery CEO. We saw you probably 2 months ago, three months ago, and the entire industry has changed again. You've had a lot of new initiatives just since then. It is like a breakneck pace, and for me, it's daunting. I'm glad you're running things. Yeah. But people are
consuming content on all platforms, and
regardless,
and it used to be everything was consumed on the TV, so you need to be on all platforms. So we're attacking it in a number of ways. In Europe, it's not that crowded. In Europe, you have Netflix. And we have a local language Netflix that competes with them, which is Dplay. We just launched a partnership about 8 months ago with ProSieben called Join, which within 6 months had over 7 million users. So what we're finding is everyone's doing scripted series and scripted movies. And in Europe, we have free-to-air and cable. We're doing local language, entertainment, nonfiction, and sports. So we're very, very local in Europe, and we're growing, and we're having real success. And then we have a number of affinity products, like golf. We own almost all the golf in the world, so it's golf TV. So yesterday I was playing with Appy Bonrat, one of the great players from Thailand.
Huge star.
Right. And so golf is a local sport. Half of the players on the PGA Tour are international. So in Thailand yesterday, we're showing Appy Bonrat playing, and I got in a little in Thailand because we're following the local players, which is working for us. And then in the U.S., we think we have something that's really unique because we don't do scripted series and scripted movies. We have the top channels for women. We have ID, TLC, HGTV, Food, Oprah Winfrey, Chip and Joanna Gaines. And so, you know, you have Viacom and CBS, they're going to put probably all their content together, and you see Disney is doing fantastically well, and Netflix. And if we go ahead, which we're looking, we think we're probably going to, that you'd pay a fee or you'd authenticate through us, and you would see all of our brands. And that's what we're the number one or number two player for women in America, and you'd see all the content you love. Plus Discovery.
Viacom and CBS and NBC's Peacock are doing this ad-supported, where you can have advertisements that show up, and maybe that's one less subscription that people need to pick up. Your plan is to do subscription-based or to include advertising, too?
You know, we have quietly been doing authenticated direct-to-consumer for the last 2 years. We call it Go. So if you like food, you could authenticate to any device and watch anything on the Food Network. You could authenticate to any device and watch anything on HGTV or Oprah. And we're generating a few hundred million dollars on that. It's because it's a younger audience. They're spending more time watching our stuff. And we're getting a little over 2 times the CPM. So there's no question that the economics on monetizing people that are consuming content on devices is very strong. You get better data. The key is that people could watch anything. So how do you curate in a way that people choose your stuff? And that's going to be the challenge for every one of these authenticated or free products. The thing that we have that we think is an advantage is when people watch TV, which is an environment where they could watch anything, the majority of women in America are watching on any given night one of our channels. And so if you saw our product and you saw Chip and Joanna Gaines and Oprah and TLC and ID and Food and Discovery, you'd be able to curate right through those brands as opposed to shows. You know, almost all those other products are saying, hey, I have Friends, so come to me, or I have The Simpsons, and come to me. So we have a lot of great shows, but we think we have a lot of great characters and brands as well.
The legacy name, the old media, instead of being disrupted, it's just a party for everyone, it seems like. But there's a lot of money being spent. I just wonder how it shakes out. But they're all there. It's not like they're gone.
Well, it depends on. It doesn't exactly feel like a party, because the truth is that media in general, the multiples on media have come down significantly in the last 5 years or so.
Is anyone going to make any money in streaming? Our margins
have gotten better. The issue is terminal value. They take a look at a company like us that last year grew mid-single. We generated over $3 billion in free cash flow. And we used to trade at a 13 or 14 multiple. We're now trading at 7 or 8 because they're saying, you may have as much or more quality IP than anyone in the world, but are we sure that in 7 or 8 years people are going to be watching it? Whereas Netflix and Disney right now, to their credit. You know, Netflix has established themselves as a direct-to-consumer product where they have credit cards, 150 million or more, and Disney is on their way. We're on our way, and it's our job to let people know that we have differentiated content, whether it's local language content outside the U.S. or all the great women's and men's content we have in the U.S., or we have all the golf and the cycling. So I think all of us, what Viacom and CBS is trying to say is, hey, I think I have enough stuff here that people will pay for it.
David, we've asked you this before, but if you're trading at half the multiple you were a year ago, does that make you a target that somebody else wants to look at and say, you've got great brands, you've got great people, we want that as part of our library because we got to get bigger?
It's actually been a longer swing. Yeah. Last year, we were up 32%. We were the best performing media stock, but we're still incredibly cheap on a free cash flow basis because the last 4 years or so, media has taken a pause where they've said, okay, let's take a look at, and let's see who's the winner. Malone, who is one of our largest shareholders and has been a great shepherd to me over the last 14 years, he bought some stock a couple of months ago. We think that we have the right pieces in order to be successful. And we have things that are unique. We're the number one international media company. We're probably the number one sports company outside the U.S.
Where were you? Pebble yesterday?
I played pretty good yesterday. I wouldn't say good.
The new swing is working.
Sea Island, Jack Lumpkin, recommended right out of Golf Digest.
Where are you playing today?
Today I'm playing Spyglass.
And Monterey.
I had a par on 7. Last time I played, I went right into the ocean, and yesterday I had a par.
On 7. So first hole out of the box, Monterey, 495-yard par 4. Do you want to see my par putt?
Are you about to put it up?
There, look. You watching? Look how long this par putt is. But David. No, but.
That was close.
No, I was playing golf with you, Joey, more than 25 years ago. You
were
always good.
Don't bring that up.
You were always very good.
Yeah, I know.
You didn't
always
show up on time, but you were really good.
Those were the days, were they not? I pulled out a driver on that par 3.
He shows up on the third hole.
These are my singles.
Because he had been out too late. He's all in a hurry. He runs out, grabs his driver. It's a par 3.
I didn't know it. They didn't tell me. And I hit a driver 100 yards over.
And it hits the house on the other side of the street.
Would have been nice if you told him par 3.
He handled it well. He took it and like put it in his like it was a weapon.
David, good luck. That was probably 30 years ago. Wasn't it?
It was 30 years ago.
Honest to God. Anyway, great to have you. And you always have you're always excited about you. That helps, I think.
You've got a good hand. We're going to try and make it happen.
Excellent.
Great to see you.
Good to see you.
Thanks for coming in.
Thanks, Becky.